Hello friends, I'm Dr. Ujwala Desai, working as an assistant professor at PES Modern College of Pharmacy, Negri, Pune.
Okay, so how incompatibility is defined? It is defined as an undesired effect occurred by prescribing, giving or mixing. So while defining, you have to mention these three words, prescribe, even if they are prescribed together, if they are given together or if they are mixed together. Then in that case, the effect is not desired. Whatever desired effect is there, say a particular drug, aspirin, its desired effect is it is a pain reliever. But if that pain relieving action is not achieved, then in that case, there must be some incompatible ingredient which has been mixed with aspirin. That's why it is not showing the action. Okay. Now, under these incompatibilities, there are three types, physical, chemical and therapeutic. So we will see each of the type in detail. So first is the physical incompatibility. Now what happens in physical incompatibility is when these substances are mixed together, they either lose their safety or appearance or therapeutic activity. Okay, means if these two ingredients are mixed together, then it may happen that whatever product is formed, that would not be safe. Second thing is the appearance may change. There may be some color change, or there may be some means initially it was a free flowing powder, but later on due to mixing it got converted into sticky powder, something like that. Appearance has changed, or the therapeutic activity has changed. For example, as I gave you aspirin, it is a pain relievant, but instead of relieving the pain, it is either increasing your body temperature, so that effect is not desired one. Okay, so due to the physical change in the physical property, the incompatibility may occur. So types is, first is immiscibility. As you all know, what is immiscibility? What is the difference between immiscibility and insolubility? Okay, so insolubility term is applicable when a solid is dispersed or dissolved in liquid, whereas immiscibility term is applicable when both solute and solvent both are in liquid form. Okay, so example is your oil and water. Both are in liquid form, so you will say that oil and water are immiscible. You will not say oil is insoluble in water. What you will say is oil is immiscible in water, but
immiscible.
But if it is in case of insolubility, example is chalk, you know, calcium carbonate, it is insoluble in water because chalk is in solid form and water is in liquid form. So there you will apply the term insolubility. Okay. So immiscibility, example is your emulsions, whatever emulsions you prepare. Okay, so initially if you prepare those emulsions without using emulsifying agent, then that will be a type of incompatibility because oil will get separated and water will get separated. Why this will happen? As okay. You all know that due to difference in surface tension, oil droplets that do not get solubilized in or mix in water. So what we do is we reduce the surface tension. How do we reduce the surface tension? By addition of surfactants.
Surfactants.
What is the function of surfactants? To reduce the
surfactants.
So by reducing the surface tension, you can overcome this immiscibility. That is, your proper stable emulsion will be formed. So what is the remedy to overcome the immiscibility is emulsification done with the help of emulsifying agent. Now here, what emulsifying agent you will add? Surfactant. Okay. Okay, so next is the insolubility. Now, as you all know, insolubility, the solid solute is not soluble in the solvent. So this term is usually applicable for the substances which are poorly water soluble. Example, as I gave, chalk, acetyl salicylic acid, aspirin. Aspirin is the synonym for acetyl salicylic acid. So these are poorly or partially soluble substances. So how will you overcome the insolubility of these substances? That is with the help of suspending agent. So next, our incompatibility under physical one is the liquefaction. So what is liquefaction? It is another term for eutectic mixture. Individual substances, they are in solid form, but when they are mixed together, they will get converted into liquids.
Liquid form.
Okay, so what is the property of these substances? They have low melting points. So due to mixing of them, what happens? Their melting point again falls, and due to which it melts even at room temperature. Okay, example is your menthol, camphor, thymol. So all the substances come under the category of eutectic mixtures. So what is the remedy to overcome this liquefaction is, what you will do is you will add an adsorbent to it. What is the property of these adsorbents? They are substances which have very fine particle size. Okay, so if the particle size is small, what will happen? The surface area will increase, and due to which more surface area will be available for adsorption purpose. Okay, so what you have to do is you have to add an adsorbent in individual substances. Like if you are mixing menthol and camphor, what you will do is you will first add an adsorbent into menthol and you will mix it together. Then you will add adsorbent into camphor, you will mix together, and then both those portions will be mixed finally together. So what will happen is, due to this adsorption process, the menthol and camphor will not come in direct contact. They have been adsorbed on the particles of kaolin or light magnesium oxide. So they will not come in direct contact, due to which the lowering of melting point will not occur and liquefaction will not occur. In addition to this, there is one more advantage of adding adsorbent, is that even if the menthol and camphor, some particles, if they come in contact and liquefaction takes place, what will happen is whatever liquid is formed, that will get adsorbed by the adsorbent, because adsorption power of these adsorbents is very high. So due to which, even if any liquid forms, the final product will not be damped due to adsorption of that liquid by the adsorbent. Okay. So now you have to always keep in mind, whenever we are discussing incompatibilities or any type of incompatibilities, you have to always mention the remedy to it. Okay. So what is the problem, an example of it, and then the remedy of it, how you will overcome that problem. Okay. So our next class of incompatibilities is the chemical incompatibilities. Now here what happens is, due to the safety appearance or therapeutic activity is lost due to chemical property change. Now what kind of chemical property change occurs? That is, either pH is changed, or due to temperature fluctuation, decomposition may occur, or since if an acid and base, they are coming together, then evolution of gas may occur, acid-base hydrolysis may occur, or any redox reaction, reduction or oxidation reaction is occurring. So in that cases, due to these changes, the safety appearance or therapeutic activity of that particular substance is lost. Now under this, there are again different terminologies which have been discussed under chemical incompatibilities. So what is immediate incompatibility? As the name itself suggests, immediate means whatever the reaction is taking place, or whatever change is taking place, that will happen immediately, means, and it is also visible to your eye. Means, say for example, acid and base, you are reacting together, CO2 is being released. So immediately, as you can say, when they will both come in contact, immediately CO2 will be released and you can also view it. So that is the immediate incompatibility. Next is the delayed incompatibility. Now what happens in delayed incompatibility is, there is a slow reaction. As you all know, rate of reaction. So when a reaction is taking place in more than one or two steps, in that case, whatever is the slowest step, that is called as the rate of reaction. That is the time required for that slowest step to complete. So that is the rate of reaction. So sometimes it may happen that the two substances are coming in contact with together, but the reaction is not immediate. It may take a long period, like for example, 7 days, 10 days, in some cases even months. So that kind of incompatibility is called as delayed incompatibility. Next is the tolerated incompatibility. Now this kind of incompatibility can be overcome. Means, say for example, there is some kind of incompatibility and you have to overcome it. So you can overcome that incompatibility by just changing the order of mixing. Okay. So what is order of mixing? Say for example, you are mixing alcohol first, some ingredient A, you are mixing it in alcohol, and then that whole ingredient you are mixing in water. See, example, this is the process. So what you will do is, you will change the order. Instead of mixing that particular substance in alcohol, what you will do is, you will mix that substance in water and then you will add alcohol and you will change the order of mixing. Are you getting? Or the next thing is, you can also modify the process. If you are going for trituration, then instead of trituration, go for heating. Instead of heating, go for some other process. So by just changing the process or by changing the order of mixing, you can overcome that particular incompatibility. So that is known as tolerated incompatibility. Whereas in adjusted incompatibility, you cannot change the order of mixing, or even if you change the order of mixing, that particular incompatibility cannot be overcome. So what is the solution to it? You have to either add or substitute an ingredient. Say for example, substance A is causing that incompatibility. So you have to either find out and substitute to that A, or what you can do is you can add a third substance which will overcome that incompatibility. So that is known as adjusted incompatibility. So in short, adjusted incompatibility cannot be overcome just by changing the order of mixing or modification. You have to finally change the substance only which is causing that particular incompatibility. So now in case of while we will be studying the remedies of chemical incompatibilities, there are two methods, method A and method B. Okay, method A is applicable for the reactions which are causing diffusible PPT. PPT here, it means precipitate. Okay, so if the method A, say for example, there is some reaction which is causing a precipitation process. So precipitate is formed. So what kind of precipitate is formed, depending on that, which method you have to adopt as a rectification to that process is has been listed over here. So method A is for diffusible precipitation and method B is for indiffusible precipitate. Now what is method A? In method A, you will divide the vehicle in two portions. Dissolve one reactant in one portion, the other reactant in other portion, and then you will mix the two portions. Okay, whereas in case of method B, what you will be doing is you will here also divide the vehicle in two portions. Okay, so in one portion you will add one substance, then and in second portion what you will do is you will take the second portion in a pestle mortar, you will add that second ingredient to it, and before adding that second ingredient, what you will add is tragacanth powder. Okay, why tragacanth powder? What is a tragacanth powder? It is an emulsifying agent. So say that it is causing any chemical reaction, what will happen is that tragacanth powder will act as a barrier and it will not allow that those two substances to come in contact. Okay, so what you will do is you will take the second portion in a mortar, you will add that tragacanth powder and you will form a uniform paste. So a small paste like substance will be formed, and then you will add the second reactant to it, and finally you will make up the volume with the remaining vehicle. Are you getting? Same procedure which had applicable for liquid paraffin. So that is method B. And method A is just divide the vehicle in two portions, mix the two substances in two different portions, and then combine them together. Okay, so now we will see each type of chemical incompatibility in detail. So first is the alkaloidal salts with alkaline substances. Now what are alkaloids? As you all know, some substances are extracted from plants or animals. So whatever these substances which have been extracted, they are classified into different groups. So one of the example is this alkaloid class. You must have heard about tannins. So that is another group. So these alkaloidal salts, example is quinine, strychnine. So these have been extracted from the plants. So their salts plus alkaline substance. So if you add these salts into alkaline medium like ammonia or NaOH or different concentration, any different substance of alkaline medium, then what will happen is this alkaloidal base will get precipitated. Why these alkaloidal salts have been prepared is, the reason behind this is these alkaloids are not soluble in water. They have solubility problems. So in order to improve their solubility, what we do is we prepare the salts and then we dispense it in drug formulations. Okay, so if you are making it come in contact with the alkaline substance, it is again going back to the alkaloidal base, which is insoluble in water. So what will happen is the amount of drug will not be properly dispensed to all the parts of the body due to solubility problem, and the whatever expected action is there, that will not occur. Okay. So this precipitation, there is one more limitation to this, is precipitation when it will occur. So this precipitation will occur only when the amount of that base exceeds its solubility in water. Say for example strychnine. Now the solubility of strychnine, I'm just giving an example. Say the solubility of strychnine is 1 gram in 100 ml. Okay, and in my formulation, the amount of strychnine is 2 grams. Okay, so now what is happening is the amount is more than its solubility. Okay, only in that case the strychnine will get precipitated. If in my formulation the amount of strychnine is 0.5 gram, so in this case precipitation will not occur because solubility of strychnine is how much? 1 gram in 100 ml, and the amount here is 0.5 gram. So whatever base is formed, that will also get solubilized, and in that case precipitation will not occur. ठीक है? So remedy to this method is what? Method A. So if you use the method A, then this problem can be overcome. Next is the alkaloidal salts with soluble iodides. Now when alkaloidal salt, they are mixed with soluble iodides. So alkaloidal salt, when it combined with soluble iodides, it will give you precipitate. So here also same condition is applicable as that we saw in solubility. If the amount is more than the solubility, then only precipitation will take place. Otherwise, it will not. And the remedy is method A. You have to adopt method A. Next is alkaloidal salts with tannins. Now here the headings itself are giving you what kind of substances are causing the incompatibility. Now like for example, alkaloidal salts with tannins. So when you combine alkaloidal salts with tannins, what will happen is precipitate is formed. So in some cases they have mentioned what kind of precipitate is formed. In some cases they have not. They have just mentioned that diffusible precipitate is formed or indiffusible precipitate is formed. Okay. So now here, as they have told, water insoluble tannates are formed. Tannates are the salts of tannins. So those are insoluble. So what the remedy you have to apply? Either method A or method B. Means here in this case, whatever precipitate is formed, it may be diffusible or indiffusible. So depending upon what type of precipitate is formed, then adopt the method. Next is alkaloidal salts with salicylates. So when alkaloidal salts are combined with salicylate, what will happen is alkaloids and salicylates will combine together and they will form alkaloid salicylate. Okay, like here example, if I take strychnine chloride, okay, strychnine chloride plus sodium salicylate will give me strychnine salicylate plus sodium chloride. Okay, so here you have to remember the examples of each of them. And whatever precipitate, now here the indiffusible precipitate is formed, so you will go for method B. Next is the soluble salicylates with alkali bicarbonates, sodium salicylate. So it will, if you combine it with alkali bicarbonate, it will give you reddish brown color. Means there is no change in the therapeutic activity, but only due to oxidation process reddish brown color occurs. Okay, and as you all know the psychology of people, that if there is change in color, they think that the particular product is not correct. So here what you will be adding as a remedy, that you will add some dark coloring agent. Means from initially only what you will do is you will give it a dark color. Since there is reddish brown color, you will add some reddish pigment to it, so that from initial stage only it will be red in color. So even if later the color changes, it will not be visible. Okay, next is soluble salicylate and benzoate with acid. So when you combine this soluble salicylate, that is sodium salicylate, plus any benzoate salt in acidic medium, what will form is salicylic acid and benzoic acid. So these PPTs, precipitates, they are indiffusible, and that's why you will adopt the method B to it. Next is soluble salicylate with ferric salts. So when you combine sodium salicylate with some ferric salt, what you will get is ferric salicylate. Okay, and indiffusible precipitate is formed, so go for method B. Next is potassium chlorate with oxidizable substances. Now potassium chlorate, when it combines with some oxidizable substance, what will happen? It may cause explosion on either heating or trituration. So what is the remedy to it? You have to triturate each of the substances separately. Means triturate potassium chlorate separately, triturate oxidizable substance separately, and then with the help of spatula you will just mix it. You will not triturate it, you will not heat it. Okay. Next is incompatibilities causing evolution of gas. Now, so carbonates or bicarbonates, when combined with acid, they will lead to the release of CO2, which is the gas. So what is the remedy of it, you have to carry out the reaction in an open vessel. See, sometimes what will happen is, say for example, if you mix these carbonates and acids together and you fill it in a bottle, after a certain period of time, what will happen? They will react together and they will lead to the evolution of gas. And since you have filled it in tightly closed container or in bottle, what will happen? That CO2 will not get space to evaporate, and as a result of which it may lead to explosion after a certain period of time due to exertion of that pressure by CO2. So what you have to take care is, whenever you are mixing these kind of substances together which leads to the evolution of gas, you carry out that reaction in an open vessel. So when you carry out the reaction in open vessel, what will happen is, whatever CO2 is releasing, that will get evacuated outside, and then you can fill the final mixture into your container. Okay, and if it happens that the rate of reaction is slow, like for example, if the reaction is taking 4 to 5 hours to release complete CO2, so in that case, what you can increase the rate of reaction by either heating. Many a times, due to heating, the rate of reaction increases, so that your time will get saved and the reaction will get completed and final product will be free of CO2. Next is liquid extract of licorice in acid media. It is a kind of spice. In Marathi, it is called as jeshtha madh. It is usually used for, it is used as a cough relevant. If you are having cough, it is a stick-like thing and it is sweet in taste. So now this licorice, it contains calcium and potassium salts of glycyrrhizinic salt. Okay. So glycyrrhizinic acid is a constituent of licorice, and its calcium and potassium salts are present in that licorice extract. So if you combine this licorice extract with some acidic drug, what will happen is, the calcium and potassium salts will combine with the acid, whatever, say HCl and all. So it will form calcium chloride and potassium chloride, and your glycyrrhizinic acid will get precipitated. Okay, and the nature of this glycyrrhizinic acid is black and sticky substance. Okay, so what is the remedy to that? That instead of going for some acid media, use alkaline media or neutral media, or use this liquid extract of licorice. See, what is the function of this licorice? It is used as a flavoring agent. So if your final substance is having acidic pH, final product is having acidic pH, so in that case, don't use this licorice as a flavoring agent. Go for some other flavoring agent. And if you are using this licorice as a API, then in that case, whatever the final formulation is there, keep the pH of that particular final formulation acidic or alkaline or neutral, so that this problem will not occur. So next class is soluble barbiturates with ammonium bromide. So here I have given an example, that is phenobarbital sodium, that is a soluble barbiturate. When it is combined with ammonium bromide, what happens is, phenobarbital precipitate is formed, sodium bromide and ammonia. Now see, soluble barbiturates, phenobarbital is a sedative, it has sedative and hypnotic action. And why it is combined with ammonium bromide is, because the bromine ion, okay, it increases the activity of this barbiturate. That's why when you combine this soluble barbiturate with ammonium bromide, so due to the bromine, there is a synergistic effect and more sedative action can be observed. So that's why these two are combined together. But the problem is what? When the ammonium bromide and phenobarbital sodium is combined together, then the barbiturate will get precipitated and this bromine ion is not free to increase the activity. So what you will do is, you replace this ammonium bromide with some other salt, because what is the final aim? You want that bromine ion. Okay, so you can take another salt of bromine, for example sodium bromide. So the sodium bromide, it will allow the bromine ion to be free, and that's why the activity of phenobarbital can be increased. Okay, so these were the chemical classes. We will just revise once the headings: alkaloidal salts with alkaline substances, alkaloidal salts with soluble iodides, alkaloidal salts with tannins, alkaloidal salts with salicylates, soluble salicylates with alkali bicarbonates, soluble salicylate and benzoate with acid, soluble salicylate with ferric salts, potassium chlorate with oxidizable substances, incompatibilities causing evolution of gas, liquid extract of licorice in acid media, soluble barbiturates with ammonium bromide. So the last type of incompatibility is the therapeutic incompatibility. So now under this, first is prescribing improper dose. So obviously, if the dose of a particular drug is not properly prescribed, sometimes what happens is the dose is given in mg, sometimes the dose is given in microgram. So you have to be careful about the unit, what unit is mentioned on prescription. Nowadays they don't give the unit. Now usually what happens is they give the trade name, and in front of trade name only they have mentioned 250, 500. So with the help of that name, the pharmacist can easily identify what drug has to be prescribed. But this dosing is very important in case of drugs which are potent. What are potent drugs? 1 mg, 2 mg, also it will show you the therapeutic effect. So in these case of drugs, even if there is a slight deviation by say 0.1 mg and all, it will show large variation in the response. So in that, in those kind of drugs, this dosing is very important. Next is prescribing wrong dose or dosage form. Wrong, it's not dose actually, it's wrong name. Usually the drugs they sound very similar, but actually they are very different in nature, like prednisone, prednisolone, or protamide, protamine. Actually these two drugs are very different, but they sound similar. So sometimes what happens is you go to the pharmacist and you pronounce the name, he may hear some else and he may give you the wrong drug. Next is dosage form. What kind of dosage form has been prescribed? Whether it is capsule, whether it is tablet, whether it is IV, whether it is syrup, whether it is suspension. So whatever dosage form one you have to prescribe, that should be proper. And if not proper, the pharmacist should consult to the doctor. See, now in therapeutic incompatibility, the role of pharmacist is very important. Okay, because all these whatever incompatibilities have been mentioned, they all can be rectified only by pharmacist. Sometimes it may happen that the doctor may prescribe wrong drug, the doctor may prescribe wrong dose. So in that case, pharmacist has to take care that whether the dose is proper, whether the name of the drug is proper, whether the dosage form is proper or not. Next is therapeutic incompatibility. Now in therapeutic incompatibility, the contraindicated drugs, what we saw. Now what do you mean by contraindicated drugs? The drugs which are not to be administered at the same time, or a particular drug, say for example I am having peptic ulcers. Okay, so in that case, you should never administer corticosteroids in peptic ulcer. It will worsen the condition. So this is a contraindication that if you are having peptic ulcer, corticosteroids should not be prescribed. Okay, you must have heard about liver damage. In liver damage condition, alcohol is never prescribed, or you should usually the patient is banned to take alcohol because it again worsens the condition. Okay, so this is the contraindication that you never take this with this. So prescribing contraindicated drugs. So the patient should always tell his history, whatever history is having of diseases, so that the doctor will take care that he will not prescribe any contraindicated drug to that particular patient according to his history. Next is prescribing synergistic or antagonistic drug. So if you are giving synergistic drugs means both the drugs having same activity. So in that case, dose is very important. So if you are giving synergistic drug, means combination of two drugs which are having synergistic effect, in that case you have to lower the dose. Otherwise what will happen? It will exceed the therapeutic window. So usually this therapeutic window is covered by two less. To the down, it is minimal effect, or what is the minimum concentration required to see the effect. Okay, so below this there will be no effect, and above line is the maximum adverse effect. So above that, yes, you will get the toxic effect. So you have to maintain the concentration of drug in that therapeutic window, that is between that minimum effect and maximum adverse effect. Okay, So when you are prescribing some synergistic drug, always keep in mind that you have to lower the dose of the both the drugs so that proper effect will be observed. Otherwise, the response will go over that maximum adverse effect line. It will cross that line and it will enter into the toxic domain. And next is the, if you are, and always, obviously, antagonistic drugs should not be prescribed together. So example of this is penicillin, as you all know. Penicillin is a beta-lactamase inhibitor. It is one of the antibiotic which is highly prescribed in case of infections. So now this penicillin, when it is combined with another drug, that is probenecid, the action of that penicillin is prolonged. So if that penicillin is having effect for say 1 day, then in that case, if you give it with probenecid, the effect of penicillin will last up to 4 to 5 days. Okay. So this is an example of synergistic drug. Antagonistic, amphetamines and barbiturates. Okay, barbiturates have sedative action. Amphetamines have awakening, or you can say excitement badhti hai if you take amphetamines. And if you take barbiturates, you feel low, you feel sleepy. So these two actions, they are completely opposite. So those are antagonistic drugs. So they should never be prescribed together. And last is wrong direction. Wrong direction, one example of this is tetracycline. You must have heard, I don't know if you have heard about this drug. Tetracycline is also one of the antibacterial drug only. Now, usually it is a complex structure, means it is a big ring-like structure, and it contains an iron into it. Now, what happens is, if you give this tetracycline with milk, whatever the calcium ions which are present in the milk, they will form a complex with that tetracycline and it will inactivate the tetracycline activity. So that's why it is always mentioned on tetracycline that never to be taken with milk. So if a doctor by mistake prescribes that take this tetracycline capsule with milk after every 8 hours, then in that case, that is a wrong direction because the activity of tetracycline will get completely inactivated. Another example of this is, see, any ointment. Okay, so it is if there is a, say, some skin ointment and it has been mentioned that apply it on eye, whether it is applicable, whether you can apply it on eye, no, because eye ointments are different. There are also eye ointments available in the market, but they are different and they are very important, sterile and isotonic. Okay, you know these two terms, right? What is sterile? Completely free from microbes and endospores. And isotonic is the tonicity of that ointment is similar to that of that of your eye fluid. So it will not cause any irritation. So eye ointments are completely different, but skin ointments cannot be applied to the eye. So these kind of wrong directions, if they are mentioned or if they are prescribed by the doctor, so it is the role of our pharmacist to rectified.